I know it's take 15, but I keep tearing up and losing my place. Oh, hello, Portland. It's good to be seen by you, I guess. So before I start my talk, I have two quick disclaimers to make. The first one is that this is not my, I'm not going to be talking at all. Well, a little bit, but my talk is not formation processes and biases in big data. Okay, so if you're here in this room for this talk, you're in the wrong room. I do not know which room you're going to be in, but Flint Dibble will not be delivering this talk, okay? Instead, I'll probably be talking a little bit about Graham Hancock and pseudo-archaeology, and well, not at all, and a lot about this guy over here. I'm going to ramble, in fact, for like another 13 minutes or so. So yeah, if you're not into that, I suggest you get up and you leave. Don't worry, I can't see you, so nice. Yeah, good to know you. Well, I probably don't know you. Yeah, cool. So the next disclaimer is I want to express the fact that I can't even tell you how upset I am that I'm not there in person. I unfortunately am, my melanoma returned a couple months ago, where I found out, and to a lymph node in my armpit, and I had surgery. They've removed it all, they think, hopefully, and I'm on a year of therapy to sort of make sure it doesn't come back, and that therapy right now is giving me really nasty fevers. I waited for a time when I don't have a fever to record this, and yeah. So I'm not there with you. And when you think about cancer, it really brings to mind sort of luck. I mean, you know, my dad, Harold, he was not so lucky. He found out about his cancer on May 25th, 2018. June 9th, he got his final diagnosis of what kind of cancer it was, neuroendocrine. June 10th, he passed. So, you know, there's with cancer, luck is all about timing after all, right? And, you know, in that sense, I am very lucky that on May 26th, I booked a ticket to Philly from Athens, Greece with Yoni, and we made it back on May 27th to Philadelphia, and I got to spend about 2.5 weeks with my dad right before he passed. And, you know, us being archaeologists, I got to talk to him a whole lot every day, and we talked a lot about archaeology, and so that's actually going to be a whole lot about what this talk is about, is those last 2.5 weeks. And you'll see why in a second, I promise. But you know, so I was so lucky to do that. In fact, you know, I will 100% of the time, I'll take the luck of spending the last 2.5 weeks with my dad versus spending 3 days with you guys. So, you know, sorry. I don't know what else to say. I might've lost a couple audience members, but you know, that is what it is. But no, I really wish I was there. After all, when I did fly back to see my dad, I had this very vivid daydream that I've remembered since then about me actually giving this talk in front of you all in person. And to not be able to do that is absolutely heartbreaking. It's been a talk I've feared and looked forward to for 5 years. But yeah, so I what I'd like to talk about, though, therefore, is kind of the topic of luck. And I have to say, like, my dad, in many ways, he was the luckiest archaeologist that you could imagine. His entire career was due to luck, right? You know, everybody here, you're hearing all these papers. He was so clever and smart, and he helped move the field forward in science and, you know, all this kind of stuff. Look, it was a whole lot of luck. I mean, it really was. And yes, you know, I'm his son. I can say that. And I relish getting back at him for all the jokes he's made at my expense. Now he cannot respond. Yeah, you were lucky, Dad. But the reality is that he would tell everybody that, you know, for the last like 10 years or so of his life, he realized after he lived later than his dad did, he realized just how lucky his life was. I mean, from like the moment of his birth, it was after World War II. He was absolutely, if you knew him well, he was very obsessed with the horrors of World War II. He saw it as such a terrible chapter of human history. And so he was obsessed with it. And he felt so lucky that he was born right after it. And he felt so lucky that he got in this horrific motorcycle accident that broke his back and a number of other bones in his body. He woke up after this truck ran a red light and, like, you know, did a number on him on this motorcycle. And he woke up in the hospital, and the doctor told him, you know, you'll probably never walk again. And he made it past that, and he started walking again. And then immediately he was drafted, but he got out of the draft and he didn't have to face the horrors of warfare because of the fact that he still had a lot of broken bones from that motorcycle accident. That's why he felt so lucky, right? And then he also felt extremely lucky with his career. You know, the connections he made from Francois Bordes being his mentor to the Bordes family that helped define where he excavated, to all of his colleagues and students and who became colleagues and hopefully maybe even me. And, you know, he had made so many amazing scholarly connections that were lucky in so many ways, right? And that helped him out, and he recognized that luck, right? And so I think that this is the important first theme I want to bring up, is luck. And just how, even on the day that he died, Harold expressed how lucky his life was. He had lived an amazing life. And so, you know, we need to recognize as a field the role that luck plays in all of our lives, right? We've all talked about the kindness and the generosity of my dad. And so much of that, I actually think on hindsight, is the fact that he recognized luck. He was humble enough to recognize the privilege and the luck that he had in his life. And at the same time, therefore, he recognized the luck that others had. He could vibe with them and be empathetic and therefore kind and generous, and recognize the good and the bad luck that people were afforded. But the second thing I want to talk about, like I said, again, was those last 2.5 weeks, right? And, you know, I've been having this conversation with my dad about archaeology for at least 20 years before he passed. And, very vibrant conversation that we had. And, you know, I obviously, so much of me and who I am as a scholar comes from him. But at the same time, I very much consciously chose to go into classical archaeology. So I had a very different set of training. I didn't want to be in his shadow. I didn't want to feel like I was getting favors because I'm his son. I'm very interested in the ancient Greek world. And so, you know, that was something that he would, I think, chafed on him a bit. But at the same time, you know, he'd always joke, like, you know, my son went into archaeology and that's like a knife in the back. I can't do his voice because we have a very similar voice, right? So I can't do a Harold impression. But I went into archaeology, it's like a knife in the back. Classical archaeology is like twisting that blade, right? And in fact, I have such a similar voice that if someone called on the phone, they'd mistake my voice for his, or my brother's voice. We have the same voice. And so that led to these very vibrant conversations about archaeology. And we continued that in the last 2.5 weeks, you know. And so in particular, I was really interested in learning about the periods before I had experienced it. It was like an adult with him. What was going on with what formed him, his earlier career? And so, you know, listening to him talk about his motivations and these events, I quickly realized something that I'd not realized before. And I said to him one day, I'm like, you know, you're a post-processualist. And this is the face that he gave me. And he's like, no, I'm not. And I'm like, no, think about it. In the 90s, you became extremely interested in context. Like, you know, you developed all these sort of methods to map it out better, to interpret it on more precise sort of levels. And then at the same time, you're really interested in humans, biases, excavators, and what they bring to things, and scholars, and, you know, these biases, humans, and what they bring to the interpretation of the archaeological record, a focus on context. That's like the post-processualist critique. And he sort of looks at me after like an hour of arguing. And he's like, actually, yeah, I'm a post-processualist. And so, you know, I start saying to him, you know, it's kind of amazing, you know, like looking at your career, you sort of define what I learned of and teach about when you think about archaeology theory 101. It's like, you know, you go from culture history, very interested in typology, Francois Bordes publishing the Paleolithic handbook, typology type stuff, to kind of that, this typology published in the cookbook, to every time I do it, I forget that slide's there. And to your nerdy processualist sort of phase where you're defining these rules and laws like scraper reduction and, you know, whatnot, to your sort of post-processualist, I'm going to look in the context and sort of critique humans and their approach to archaeology and stuff like that. And what happened next is what I ask him. He's like, you know, Because maybe that'll help answer that question. You know, in archaeology theory 101, you know, you have that student that's always like, what comes after post-processualism? And it's sort of like, well, stuff. And so my dad's like, well, you know, I think it's archaeological science, right? You know, you think about it, the approaches of isotopes, DNA, the different experimental approaches, that's what really revolutionized the next step, the 21st century. And I'm thinking to myself, yeah, that's a good point, right? You know, but at the same time, because I'm a zooarchaeologist at this point, so I do a lot of these things. But at the same time, I have my classics training and I'm thinking to myself, you know, there's so much more to what 21st century archaeology is. And so we eventually compromise on this idea that what the next phase of 21st century archaeology is interdisciplinary explosion in a sense, right? You know, what we see today in archaeology is you have to be interdisciplinary. To get funding, you have to be putting together new ways of methods and approaches, combining different things that have never been combined before, to be in the news, all these things. And then you look at the way archaeology is run in the field and labs, it's all interdisciplinary collaboration, right? So we have this light bulb moment, and we're just sort of like, oh yeah, let's write a paper on this together. A Dibble and Dibble venture. We've never done that before. I mean, we haven't had a poster together. We wrote some software on barcoding, but never like a paper. And so we're just like, yeah. So let's think about like how we can make this interesting. You know, what are the upsides of it? Oh, you can do all this different kind of research. Archaeology's always been interdisciplinary, but now it's just at this umpteenth level. You can't think of a single field in arts, sciences, humanities, social sciences, whatever. This never had a collaboration with archaeology. So much is being done. But at the same time, there's a flip side. We can add some nuance. It builds up these sort of barriers of communication, right? You know, it's really difficult to communicate across, and we're becoming increasingly siloed based upon these sort of sub-disciplines and stuff like that, right? So it's a great idea. And then my dad sort of stops and he looks at me like this. So, you know, I'm like, what's up? What's wrong? He's like, well, this is the first time I've had a really exciting research idea, and I don't know if I'm going to live to be able to see it through. And well, you know, that shut down the conversation a little bit, right? But we continued talking about it over the next few days, and we sort of worked out a few different ideas. And one of them was the paper that I was originally going to present, you know, that you have this sort of new big data approaches. And maybe we need to rethink these because we want, it's like a black box. We put all this data in and we get sort of these patterns out. But when you think about archaeology and formation processes in context, maybe we should be using big data first to understand context and formation processes, right? Because that really impacts things. And that's what I was going to present on some of my own research and stuff. But I've been very feverish, so I haven't put together that paper. But in the future, and if anybody, I really want to make this clear, I want to write both of these papers. I mean, obviously I'm moving forward on the formation processes and biases. That's part of my grant. The other one, this sort of change, if anybody wants to collaborate, reach out, please. Okay. But yeah, so Dad, I love you. I love everybody there. I want to end on a sort of a, you know, I haven't had any jokes in here yet, so I got to have one quick sort of, you know, joke. I animated a photo of my dad with some of that software. I was animating ancient sculptures, and so I thought, hey, what can it do? So yeah, that's kind of freaky, isn't it? Good luck. Love you all. Have a toast in honor of Harold.